So excited about this message. The Lord just laid this on my heart last week, just looking at the evil in our world. But you know what? There is an unseen hand, and there's an unseen plan. And I want to play a song, and I want you to hear the song. Most of you will remember this song. But listen to the words of it. And then we're going to talk about angels today. And I think it's going to bless your heart, because it sure has mine.
I was walking home from school on a cold winter day. Took a shortcut through the woods, and I lost my way. It was getting late, and I was scared and alone. But then a kind old man took my hand and led me home. My mama couldn't see him, oh, but he was standing there. And I knew in my heart he was the answer to my prayer. Oh, guide us with the light of love. When life held troubled times and had me down on my knees, there's always been someone to come along and comfort me. A kind word from a stranger can lend a helping hand. Phone call from a friend just to say I understand. But ain't it kind of funny at the dark end of the road that someone lies away with just a single ray of hope?
About this, you'd say you've got just about to jump out of your seat thinking, I've got an angel story. Man, I got a story to tell you about an angel. And so, you know what, if you have a story that you'd like to tell about an angel experience, or not that you've seen one, but maybe experienced one, and we'll talk a little bit about what that means. But if you have something you just hanker to share like that, maybe next week, because it's going to be like a two-week series, because I'm going to talk about today. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take you on a Bible overview of angels from Genesis right on through the Bible. Now, I will skip many stories about where angels appeared and intervened, because we don't have time. We'd be here a month. Because there are 108 times in the Old Testament that mentions angels. There are 165 times in the New Testament that talk about angels. What is that, 278? What is that, Daniel? 108, 165.
Put me on the spot.
273.
Okay. Well, I was close. I got close. You know, that's usually how I get the math. So, 273 times is a lot of references to angels. And they intervened and they appeared on times that were huge in history. All right? Now, you say, well, I'm not sure I really believe in angels. Well, if somebody asked me, and I'll tell you right now, with all of my heart, I believe in angels. I believe there are billions just standing, waiting at the beck and call of the Lord, and they're there for us. Because the Bible says in Hebrews, we'll look at the verse again here in a little bit, but it says that are not all angels ministering spirits sent to minister or help those that are going to inherit salvation? Those who become God's children, they are there to protect. And I believe that every child of God has a biblical justification for the fact that you have, every believer has at least two guardian angels over you. By the way, just a side note, somebody gave me some good advice one time. They said, you know, your guardian angel can only do the speak language. So that's what you get out there a little beyond that, you're on your own, man. So just something for you to remember. But if somebody asked me, you know, why do you believe in angels? I'm going to tell you today why I believe in angels. I'm going to tell you a couple angel stories that are true stories, some in my own life and some in others. And this will just, this is one of those goose pimple messages, I believe. If you, because man, I, you know, when I think back what God's done in my life and I look at other people's stories, and I've heard other stories over the years, you know, 30 years of ministry, and I've seen people dying that there was no doubt in my mind, because they would say, do you see them? And they'd see what? Do you see them? And they would talk about the angel. And my sister saw something that she wasn't able to mention because they had taken her speech with her brain surgeries. But she smiled and pointed. And she had been comatose for 3 months, totally unresponsive. So I have seen, by watching people die, and in people's life, the experience that they've shared with me, I have seen so many times that it's like, there's no doubt in my mind, there's angels. Let me tell you something though. I don't believe in them because I've actually seen one. Although I will tell you that I have encountered them. And I'm going to give you a couple stories today about how I know I encountered an angel. I didn't see them. On the other hand, I also believe, we'll talk about this next week, that angels can take human form. And I'm not trying to be Hollywood or Disney, right? But they can't. If they couldn't take human form, then why would the Bible say, by doing certain things, you have entertained angels unaware. There's a great story that old Grandpa Jones, remember him from Hee Haw? Now I'm really redneck, man. But anyway, you know, one of my favorite. That was our staple program. But old Grandpa Jones used to tell a Christmas story about a man who heard from the Lord. And the Lord said, I'm coming to see you today. And he lived in an old cabin all by himself. He's like, oh, you're coming to see me. And he said, man, I mean, he started putting the garland and the decorations, and he baked a cake, and he made some fresh coffee, and I mean, he just got the place ready. And out the door come a knock, and there was an old boy standing out there that was beat up and bruised and hurt. And so he brought him in, and he warmed him by the fire, and he gave him some hot coffee, and put a blanket around him, and fed him a meal, and then sent him on his way. And then, but he looked at the clock, and he was a little disappointed. Because he's like, man, Lord, I thought why would you be so late? You said you'd come today, it's getting late. Well, another knock came at the door, and it was a little gal there that was freezing, and she just needed, it was Christmas Eve, and she just needed some company and a place to rest for a few minutes. She was on a journey, and she said, please don't send me away. I just need a little time to rest. And he lit her warm by the fire, gave her a warm cup of tea, served her some cake, sent her on her way. Another knock, and now he's getting really disappointed, though. He's like, Lord, I just don't understand. And another knock came at the door, and it was a little girl, and she was lost. And so he helps the little girl. He gets her a warmer coat, and then he guides her and leads her on her way. He actually brought her in, let her get warmed up, gave her a bite to eat, then he leads her home. And when he gets back, it's now really late. So he goes in, and he kneels down beside his bed, and he said, Lord, did I not hear you right? I was sure you said you were going to come today. I missed it. How did I misunderstand? And a light came shining right down right on the bed where he was praying, and he heard this voice. He said, oh, son, I did come. He said, I came today in three people. I came to your door as the man that was hurting and wounded, and you invited me in, and you took care of me. I came as the woman who needed a place to rest and some company and a little sprightly girl, and you gave me a respite every time. Well done. And then he praised God because he realized, oh. And you see, that's what it means, entertained angels unaware, right? Sometimes there are those. Now, I have a feeling sometimes my guardian angel is bipolar. You know, and let me just stop here just for a second. I want to mention this because I don't want to forget it, right? So, there's some ladies in here that are selling tickets to it next Saturday night. They have a dance recital. Michaela's going to be doing her dance, and if you have never seen her dance, you're missing it. And my little granddaughter, JC, will be dancing. Opal's girls are dancing. And I don't know if some of your kids are in the...
I think I got one in there.
In the buffet. All right. Good. We're just glad you're not doing it, brother.
They asked, but I... Yeah,
that's just a hard picture to get out of your head. But I wanted to mention that because they're going to be selling tickets, you know, today. And so I let's get our tickets and go encourage these girls. And they work really hard and they're really cute. So, all right. So I don't believe in angels because someone else told me they've seen one. Because, you know, you see it, right? You got a lot of people that are into that hypersensitive or whatever you call it, sensationalism. And, you know, we want to, you know, build up our story and whatever, and they'll tell you all about the angel or whatever. Now, some people, it is as true as can be. Then there are others, you can just kind of tell they're looking for attention. I don't believe in angels because of the thousands of stories that I've heard over the years or read. It's hard. I mean, you just go Google a little search on angels, encounters with angels. Okay? And you'll be split. I don't believe in angels because of Hollywood's depiction of angels, which has gotten really pretty good, actually. And interestingly enough, though, it's always evil angels, right? Mm-hmm. The city of fallen angels. And, you know, it's always demonic, and it's just kind of weird. Here's why I believe in angels. Because the Bible says there's angels. That's good enough for me. That's all I need to know. And so now when I think about that, I think about the stories in the Bible that I want to share with you. And let me just ask you these questions really quick as I share a couple of personal stories. But here's another angel story for you. Let's just ask this question. Did they see an angel? Hey, did they see an angel? It was a cold wintry night, and a knock came at the door of a famous neurosurgeon. And the little girl said, please come quick. My mommy is very, very sick. And he said, well, honey, now he didn't make house calls. He's a neurosurgeon. But he said, oh, all right, honey, just a second. Let me get my guy's coat. And he went through the cold winter night with her, and they got to the house, and he found the woman. She was dying pretty quick. So he tended to her the best he could and did all he could, and then he called the ambulance. As they were getting ready to load her into the ambulance, he said, ma'am, he said, you should be very proud of your little girl. He said, she came and fetched me, and if it wouldn't have been for that, you would be gone. And he said, you should be very proud. That's a fine young lady you have. She goes, what little girl? My daughter died 3 months ago. And that's a true story. And he said, what? She goes, that's her wardrobe right over there. And he went and opened it up out of curiosity. There was the dress and the stockings and the shoes that she was wearing when she came to get me. I told you. That's just one, all right? There's some more coming, all right? So these are all true stories. And some of these, you know, they used to have the guidepost. Anybody ever read the guidepost? These are great, man, they've got all kinds of stories in there about angels leading people, you know, out of the snow and stuff. So did they, did he see an angel? This neurosurgeon. This week, I had an interesting experience. I was driving my truck, which is just as faithful as could be, and it's the toughest truck on this planet. That's just how it is, boys. Challenging. So, but this truck has never given me problems. I'm pulling up to a stop sign at the college. I just pulled out of college, taught my class, pulled up to the stop sign at the stop sign. Man, I mean, this truck goes like that, and it felt like I fell into a hole, and I thought, I didn't see that. I thought I fell into a hole. The lower ball joint of that truck came off, and the CV joint came off. The tire buckled under, out, and back into the fender, and if that would have happened at 50 or 60 miles an hour, I'd be pushing up daisies and taking the dirt back. Now, did I see an angel? I didn't see an angel, but did that happen at that stop sign? Because God is protecting me. You know, you be the judge, in my opinion. Thank you, Lord. Especially on the week I'm talking about angels, because I believe that angel just kicked my tire off. Kicked it loose because it would have happened on the highway. I had a friend, and let's go to the next slide here, Hannah. This ought to make you cry. Now, Dan Anders, get your Kleenex, because, you know, he can't tell these stories. He was in Vietnam, and he's got some stories to tell. And you look at that picture, that was him, okay? But I had a buddy, his name was a big cowboy, Brad knows him, his name was Marlon Holt, big strong cowboy, he's not a sissy, is he? I mean, a big strong boy. Right off of the farm, goes to fight in Vietnam. He was on night duty. He told me this story with tears streaming down his cheeks. And he said, I was scared to death. He said, I knew I was going to die that night. I knew it. I knew I was going to die that night. He said, I can't even tell you how fearful I was. In the area that we were in, and he says, I looked across the way, and he says, and there sat an angel on a bale of hay. He saw the angel. Now, this wasn't a guy that, he's not a sensational type, he's just an old redneck cowboy, and this, and he, I'm telling you, this was dripping off his chin. He saw an angel. Hey, go to the next one, Helen. For you vets, that's for you. Because I know, and Dan can tell you stories of bullets zinging over his head, taking other people and didn't take him, and it's hard for him, okay? But just think about this. Last year, when I did Eleanor's funeral, this old lady, dear old lady and friend of mine that I'd had for so many years as a friend, when she was dying, I think I told you this at the time, she said, can you see her? And we said, what? And we're looking over there, and there was an empty chair. She goes, there's a girl sitting in that chair. She's dressed in white, and she's got her head down like this, and she started describing her to us. Well, I'll tell you next week, I'll be sharing with you how I believe that there are death angels. There are angels that escort us at death to heaven. And I think that's why I've seen so many people when they were dying, either with a smile or pointing or saying, can you see them? I've seen it so many times. And that happened with Eleanor. And she didn't say she had wings or anything like that, okay? She just said, can't you see her? I think that was her escort angel. In 1981, I was driving back from Grand Junction, or Delta to Grand Junction to go back to school for the, like, come home on weekends and see my dad and everybody. And I know I won't drive sleepy. I mean, if I'm sleepy, I pull over and go to sleep. Oh, I was fighting. For whatever reason, I wanted to get home. And I was fighting, and I was fighting. And all I remember is I had a hand grab me right here and the top of my head and went like that, and I looked up and I was headlight to headlight with a car, and I had no time to swerve. And I swear that car, it was like it was picked up and set in the other lane. I can't explain. I pulled over, it was so phenomenal that I pulled over to the side of the road and I threw up. I'm getting scared now, it was that close. And I threw up and I cried my eyes out, and then I praised God because I saw how close it was and I felt the hand. I knew nobody can tell me that that wasn't an angel. 1982, my father passed away. On the day he passed away, I told my roommate, he said, what can I do? And I said, don't worry, just sit tight, I need a minute. And I went in the room, my bedroom, and I sat on the edge of the bed, and I just put my head down. And I think I told you the story, but I had a hand that would make Brad's look like a baby's hand. But it just felt like it, the fingers came all the way down to here, and the thumb would have hit me in the scapula. And it was a strong grip. And I thought it was my roommate, although the hand was way too big. But I went like that, because I thought he was there to comfort me, and there was nobody there. I was being told, I'm here. I've got you. It's okay. You cannot tell me that wasn't an angel, an angelic presence, because in my life, it was as real as it could possibly get. And then I told the story before about my sister, you know, the phone call when I was at my darkest hour, my very darkest hour. And I just wanted to check out. I was like, Lord, take me home. And the phone rings. And it was a gal who had, for those of you that don't know this story, she was my sister's best friend. My sister had passed away 20, 30 years before. Okay? And this was her best friend in high school. And she said, Mark, I don't know. She said, do you remember who I am? And I said, yes, I do. You were my sister's best friend. You were at her wedding. You were a bridesmaid. Or you were a maid of honor. And she said, well, I don't know what's going on in your life. But today, she said, I had an experience. Your sister was sitting right beside me in the car. And she said, go call my brother Mark and tell him everything's going to be fine. And she broke down, she cried. She said, it scared me to death at first, but she looked so good. And she said, it was so real. She said, I know something big must be happening in your life. Because I'm calling you because I don't know, but I'm just telling you. And sure enough, the next day it all turned around and all things were good. Can't tell me. That wasn't God using human form or something to be able to get a message across. Joyce Meyer, for those of you that some like and some don't, for whatever reason, but she's travels the world, preaches the gospel. There was a man that was unsaved. He came with his wife, and when she came out on stage, he said, "Can you see? Do you see him?" And in fact, I've always wanted to draw this picture for her and send it to her, because he saw two angels walk out with her and stand with their swords tip to tip while she preached, and it was right over the top, like side to side. And it brought him to Jesus Christ. And she tells that story. It's really cool. So anyway, there's just a few little stories. And I know you have yours too. And everybody can tell some great stories. Let's do a little Bible journey here. And I'm going to take you real quick, just through the Bible, in pictures. And I had to work hard. I either found these pictures or I had to make them with my own Photoshop stuff and stuff, because I wanted it to be a certain way to be able to tell the story in pictures, all right? So where do we get our angels? And next week, here's where we're going. These are the questions we're going to ask next week. Who or what are angels? What are they? Well, we know they're created beings, for one thing. Are there different kinds of angels? Yes, there's cherubim, seraphim, there's archangels. What's the difference? We'll talk about it. How did angels originate? Where'd they come from? How many angels are there? Do angels have bodies? Can they take on human form? What do angels look like, really? Do people become angels after they die? That this is something that, you know, a lot of people are like, well, if he does good enough. Remember the It's a Wonderful Life with Jimmy Stewart? And Clarence the angel? Well, you know, if he did enough good or whatever, he got his little bell ring, that means he got his wings or whatever and got to heaven? Well, that's Hollywood, all right? How do angels compare to human beings, and are all angels good? So we're going to look a little deeper at those things next week. This week, we're just looking at the top of the overview here. Where did we, you know, one of the greatest, most beautiful angels of all time, let's show that next slide. He was the most beautiful angel, was who?
Lucifer,
who did what? In pride, he wanted to be like God. And he said, I'll be like him, and I'll be like the Most High. And even though he was the most beautiful of all the angels, he was cast out of heaven with a third of the angels, which a lot of people believe are the demonic spirits that we have to deal with. And our angels are dealing with in the unseen realm. Ephesians chapter 6, we war not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and powers in the unseen realm. Listen, folks, there's germs in this room you can't live, scare you to death. If you could see the germs on those pews that you're sitting in, and on those handrails, and it can scare you to death. There is an unseen realm. And just as there are germs, there are demons, and there are angels. And so he gets cast out because of his pride. And this is where we wind up getting this. And then Adam and Eve blow it in the garden. And so then they're kicked out of the garden. And who's put there to keep them from coming back in? An angel of the Lord. Let's show the next slide. Okay. Now, this slide, I debated on whether I wanted to point and get out, you know. But I also wanted to kind of maybe use this one for, we have angels that defend us, you know. And he might be telling a demonic, you know, force or something to get out of our life also. But this is the, this would be an angel with a fiery sword that kept them from coming back in. It was an angel that was put in guard there. Okay, then we have Abraham. He met three people, right? Three people. And now this picture is a little misleading because it shows them with their wings and all that. I don't believe they had wings in that story. I believe, now I'm not saying angels don't have wings because we know they do. Because that the Bible describes it. Not all, but that doesn't mean they always come with wings. They might come as Pat McKee. Now that, he's more like Clarence. You know. I want to pick on one to know again. So, but see, yeah, but you know, it's like that old boy that asked that lady. She said, "I don't know how I'm going to get when I get to heaven. I don't know how I'm going to get my coat over my wings." He said, "I wouldn't worry about that, lady. I'd worry about how you're going to get that hat over your horns." You know, so, anyway, but they came as people, but he recognized them as from God. He knew they were from the Lord, and so he treated them that way, knowing that they had a message from God. And then one of my favorite stories, because I could see me doing this. You know, old Jacob, he wanted a blessing so badly that he was willing to wrestle an angel. Man, I've been out there trying to hit him with a low single or a double leg or cow catcher or something, trying to get that old boy down if I was going to get my blessing. But what does he do? He wrestles with him for a little while, and tweak, he tweaks his hip, right? That crippled hip wound up being his blessing. You don't see it at the time. You think, boy, he was in a lot of pain. He lived the rest of his life. But there was a humility that came at that point in his life that caused him to be blessed like he had never been before. He wrestled with God. He wrestled with the angel of the Lord. That's Genesis. Abraham and the three men are Genesis 18. Jacob wrestling with the angel is Genesis 32, verse 22 through 32. And then we have Jacob's ladder. And it says there in Genesis 28, 10 through 22, it says that he saw them angels ascending and descending down this ladder. I had a school teacher when I was a kid. She used to scare us kids half to death. She'd tell us a story about somebody she knew that was dying, and she saw this very vision when she was dying, the angels going up and coming down and so on. And it was kind of a cool story. But so this is a vision that Jacob gets, and that's why we call it the whole story of old Jacob's ladder. Now, then there's the story of old Daniel when he gets thrown in the Best Western Lion Motel, right? And he's got to, you know, I love this picture. It's Daniel chapter 6, all right? And it's very clear that the angel of the Lord shut the mouth of the lions, okay? He could have just let them munch him, but his time hadn't come yet. And until his time was come, now, if his time would have come, that angel would have been there to take him home, right? That's what he'd been doing, but this time, he was keeping the thing that could hurt him, it could kill him, like a tire falling off. That was my line. I'd say that could have killed you just as quick as a set of lions, right? So it was the angel of the Lord that did it. Now, then we have in 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8 through 23. Now, one of my favorite stories in all the Bible. Hold that slide for just a minute, Hannah. Elisha. Now he's been Elijah. Elijah was the old prophet. And he had Elisha, the boy, and he was, you know, he was the apprentice, right? Remember when he was bald-headed? You know, he had a crew cut, the crew bailed out. But he was just a bald-headed kid, and them kids started making fun of him. "Hey, get thou up, old bald head, get thou up." Poking fun at him, and God sent a she-bear out of the wilderness months of kids for doing that to him. Cool. Elisha's a great story. What's that? Did I say something? So, did I say something weird? My son's back there laughing. Okay, so, that usually means, Dad, you don't believe what you just said. Anyway. So, here's the thing. Where was I? Oh, yeah, Elisha. Okay. All right, so Elisha, all right? Elisha is there. He's now got his little apprentice, his servant. And what happens is what is now was ancient Syria, okay? And at that time, they were putting together an army. They were going to come down on this city. And they heard that Elijah's prayers were, you know, he was stopping things. Elisha was able to see where they were going to attack, and it made him mad. So they decided, we're going to get thousands and thousands. We're going to overwhelm them with horses and chariots, and we're going to surround this city. So this young boy, Elisha's servant, said, sir, we're in some deep squat. What do we do? And he just prayed. The old Elisha prayed, and he said, Dear Lord, open this boy's eyes so that he can see what I see. Now here's what he saw. You can go to the next one. Alright, there it is. There they are. So around the entire place, those are angels and chariots. The entire place was surrounded by angels and fiery chariots. And he was allowed, because what was happening was the boy was focused on the seen realm, and Elisha was looking at the unseen realm. One brings strength, confidence, and comfort. The other brings fear. So you and I, when we are facing problems and our enemies in life are surrounding us, we need to keep our minds on the fact that, oh Lord, help me to see those unseen angels that are all around me. Right? Soldiers that go into battle, great thing for them to remember is that He will encompass the righteous, right? And so, just like the great story, I just love that story. And then we have, sometimes angels are used for avenging or judgment, which was the case, if you look in Genesis chapter 19, when you have time, we have Sodom and Gomorrah, right? Now that angel came, and those are the two angels. They came and they said, all right, look, they came to Lot's house. And then the people were so whacked out. And really, I can see our society doing this very same thing. Those angels are there, and they're in Lot's house. And so all those people come out in the streets, and they're like, hey, let them two angels come out, or those two fellas, whatever, so we can all have sex with them. Isn't that weird? And that's how, I can see our society doing that. And so they're like, yeah, well, we'll see about that, right? And so what happens is they get them out of the town. He saves Lot, again, because he'd been saved before by Uncle Abraham, right? But he gets him out of the city. Lot's wife looks back, turns the pillar of salt, but he spared him, the righteous, but they brought fire and judgment, right? And somebody's well said that if the Lord doesn't come back pretty soon, he's going to owe Sodom and Gomorrah an apology, right? Because we're more wicked than they were, pretty much. All right, so now, then we have the angels, and now we're in the New Testament. We have the angels that are announcing the birth of Christ. Isn't it interesting? It's angels that do it. Like, come in myriads, and these old shepherds are out here in the fields. And they're like, and what do these angels say? What's the first thing they say? Fear not. I have a feeling if we're out watching a bunch of sheep, and all of a sudden there's this bright light and angels, you'd be a little startled, right? Fear not, right? Because I bring you good news of great tidings. I'm here to bring you a whole new life. Amen. So here we are. This is kind of what started me thinking about this. Was the Christmas season coming up, and we have the angels, right? You know, the angels are the ones who make the announcement. We do know the names of two of the angels, Hark and Herald, right? Hark and Herald, the angel. Yeah. All right, so he comes to those shepherds, and then let's go to the next one. Wouldn't that be cool? I mean, can you imagine just being there in that serene moment, and there this bright angel shows up and says, your lives are about to change. The world is about to change. Things are going to be just a little different. Then the angel Gabriel, and that was in Luke chapter 2, but in Luke chapter 1, Gabriel appears to Mary. Actually, at first he appears to Zacharias. All right? And listen, so there you go, he got married. And he's telling her that she's going to be blessed above all women and so on, which our Catholic friends have taken to a little higher level, making her a little more than probably what God intended. But at any rate, there we are. She's getting it out. Let's go to the next one. Now he comes to Zacharias, and he tells Zacharias that, look, you're John the Baptist. You know, this is when John the Baptist will be born, so he's talking about Elizabeth and all that. Now, I don't know why the Lord gave, you know, he came to Zacharias. Now, wouldn't it make sense? Wouldn't you like an angel to come to you and tell you that your wife is pregnant? And you heard that from God. Oh, you're telling me my wife is pregnant. It's not from somebody else. All right, good. That's good. Joseph didn't get that benefit. He didn't get that. Can you imagine? So he just, it's like, Joseph, I have something to tell you. Really? Yes, I'm pregnant. Good. Now, if he had heard it from the angel first, that would have been good, right? But he didn't. So, for whatever reason, he told Zechariah first, and then he told Elizabeth and that. But then he came to Mary, and then Joseph does get told a little later on, right? Here's what he says to her. Listen to this. Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God, and behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Hallelujah. I'm about done. Then there was Jesus, he was helped in the wilderness. Remember when he was in temptation for 40 days, 40 nights, out of food, been tempted every day of his life, and who knows how many, but we know he was tempted every way we are. And go to the next one, yeah? So the angels comforted him, all right? They came and they assisted him. Angels. He didn't just pull himself up by his bootstraps. Even Jesus was to the point of weakness of saying, I need some help. And the Lord sent him angels to help. And if he sent Jesus angels, don't think he won't send them to you. And he came to him in his darkest hour. What was his darkest hour, by the way? Right before the crucifixion, I think. And what would that be? In the Garden of Gethsemane, right? Why? Because that's where he's praying, oh God, if there's any other way to save this bunch of sheep than to have to go through this. Because he knew. He wasn't worried about the pain and the beating and the pluckings and the spitting. And he wasn't worried about that. What he didn't want is to bear the weight. He'd been pure for eternity. And for him to bear the sin, your alcoholism, your pornography addiction, your adultery, your idolatry, your complaining, for him to bear that and become a curse for you, put him in his darkest hour. He literally had the weight of the entire world, past, present, and future, on his shoulders. And God sends an angel. Next one, Hannah. So there he is, and it's an angel of the Lord. I love that picture. Isn't that beautiful? Now you picture yourself in your darkest hour. Because this is where I was. And that phone call from my sister literally was just the same experience. Next one. And here, he takes him from being about ready to collapse, bleeding sweat, to being able to be upheld by the mighty hand of God to accomplish yours and my redemption. Now at Calvary, what does it say? He could have called 10,000 legions of angels. I forget how many that is. I'll be able to tell you next week. But I think it's like 170,000 is a legion. He could have called 10,000 legions. But all he had to do was say, come. Right? And it would have wiped out the human race and forget about this curse, taking the curse thing. But he did not. So next one there, Hannah, where he could have called them. Can you imagine? He had all of them at his disposal. He could have said, all right, get me out of this. But he said, you know what? I love John so much. Stay put. I love Judy so much. Just stay put. Stay put. Then, at the resurrection, we have, this one's kind of cool. It says, the angel rolled the stone away. Right? So we have this angel rolling the stone away. And this is the comical part of that story. And you can find it in Mark chapter 16, 5 through 7. Go to the next one, Hannah. This is the next one. There he sits on the stone. I think this is just, you know, isn't that great? The Lord has a sense of humor. You know what? I'm just going to plop him up there on that big one. This is the thing that was blocking the tomb, and it took probably 50 men to roll that thing into place, and it locks down, and there's an interesting way they put him. But he's just sitting there. I can just see him dangling his feet, like, what y'all doing? What you doing here? He's not here. He's risen. He's happy he can be. And he's just letting them know it's all good. I love that, right? It's an angel that does that. And then in Acts chapter 12, the apostle Peter gets broke out of jail. The angel comes in, and he takes what cannot be done. He doesn't have, he's not subject to bars and walls, and he appears, and he says, get yourself ready. We're going, oh, and it's really cool, too. He says, take your coat. Now, isn't that kind of ridiculous? Oh, don't, get your coat. Now, why would, this I think just shows the father heart of God. Why would he tell you to get your coat? Because, son, it's cold outside. I want you to be warm. Right? Man, this blesses my heart. And so, get your coat. We're going. And the walls fall down. Everything goes. And he makes what was impossible possible. And he'll do the same for you and I. What is your jail? What is your situation where you need a wall knocked down or the bars taken out? Don't forget your coat because God loves you. Two more points here. Second coming of Christ in Matthew 20, in Revelation, of course, chapter 20, and in Matthew 25, we have the second coming of Christ where Jesus is going to come back with his angels. He's coming back with his angels. And we're going to see it. We're going to see it. And it's going to be a beautiful sight. Next week. Yeah. And I don't think we're going to be able to, oh, should be one more. Should be another one of Jesus. There we go. Yeah. Revelation 19. Now I saw a heaven open up, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was faithful and true, and his head was wore many crowns, and he was clothed with white robe dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. The armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on a white horse. This is where we get the fine clothes, and the white, and the linen, and the always radiant, and so on, right? Now, I left out a lot of stories of angels. Do you understand that? Last one. The old devil is going to be finally put on the chain gang. And that's what it says. An angel will be chaining him and throwing him into the abyss. Okay? And he will be, and then he's going to be there for all eternity. He's going to come up out of that pit and going to be cast into the lake of fire at another time. Next week, we'll look a little bit more specifically at what angels are and all of that, but I hope, you know, I'm sure you probably got some stories, and I can't wait to hear them. And we have potlucks, so you can tell your angel story. Okay? Don't tell that one that old men always like to tell. My wife's an angel because she's always up near her heartbeat about something. Careful with that one. I've seen a lot of men get a beating on that one. Let me close with this story. It was Christmas Eve, and it was Jim and Don. And they were college roommates in the Midwest University. And they were, they wanted to get home. And they all went to the same school. And one of them lived in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Two of them lived in Chicago. Well, the roads were treacherous. In fact, the roads were so bad, the radio announcers were saying, stay in, don't go out, it's dangerous. There were record-breaking wind chills of, this is a true story, 80 degrees below zero. That's the wind chill factor. Man, that'll freeze you right to the ground. And so, they were advising, don't travel, don't go. Get out and stay home. But these guys, it's Christmas Eve, we want to get home. And so they foraged. And they got all the way into Indiana. And it was only 2 more hours to get to Fort Wayne. And so they foraged on. And they made it to Fort Wayne. That's where Don's parents lived. And so they dropped him off. They went in the house and had some cider with him and talked a little bit. And they said, well, we're going to go on ahead and go to Chicago. It's only about 4 hours from here. And they said, boys, we just really don't feel good about that. And we really think you should stay put. The weather advisories, it's 80 below zero. We're talking, you're going to die, if you break down. They said, well, you know what, we've done really well, the car's done really good, we've only got 4 more hours, it's Christmas Eve, we want to get home. So they took off, and they were gone about 30 minutes. And at that 30-minute point, there's an access road that would take them over to a toll expressway on the highway. Well, there was no cars. They weren't seeing any cars or nothing. Well, when you got out of that road was 11 miles long, that access road. Well, there was nothing on the access road. There were no houses, no lights, no nothing. No cars, nobody coming, nothing. It kind of went up on a hill, and they were actually able to see highways and roads and stuff. No lights, no cars, no nothing. And they said, boy, everybody else must have heeded the wise decision. And Tim's car had been doing okay all this time, but now it was starting to sputter, and it was starting to lose power. And that happened for a few minutes, and it finally died. And there on the side of the road, in between that 11-mile stretch of nothing, 80-degree weather, and that car started getting really, really cold. To the point, really, they knew that if one of us gets out and tries to go find help, we're going to freeze to death. We won't live through it. But they were already going into hypothermia in the car. And they were getting desperate, and they were fearful. And so Jim says, let's pray. And he said, oh God, you are our only hope. You are the only thing that we can do, that we can trust. We need help. And they no more said amen to the prayer. And here comes some headlights up the road. And they had been looking for headlights off in the distance and stuff. They had a long view. Nobody was out there. Well, here come the headlights, and there was a big, strong guy come and knocked on the window. He had a tow truck. He knocked on the window, and he said, boys, need some help? Need a tow? And they said, oh, sir, you have no idea how thankful we are you're here. So we got him hooked up, and they crawled in a nice warm cab. They called Don's parents and said, we're coming back after all. We like to die down here. A tow truck driver's bringing us in. Well, he drove through the town. Fort Wayne, thank you. Through Fort Wayne, and as he's driving through the town, he's going through the back streets, and he goes down the street where Don lived. And they said, and they had asked his parents, Don's parents, can we borrow some money to pay the tow truck driver? They said, you bet. So they got there, they said, sir, we'll be right back. We're going to go grab the money real quick. We're going to pay you for the tow. We can't tell you how much we appreciate it. They went to the house, took about 5 seconds, grabbed the money from Don, and Don's parents came out to thank him also. They went out, no tow truck. Not only was there no tow truck, there was no tow bill, there was no tow truck driver, and there was no tail lights going off in the distance. It was just a quick give you the money and go back out. To top it off, there were no tow truck tracks. Nowhere. No tow tracks. In that neighborhood, there wasn't any kind of car tracks, let alone a tow truck, with duties on it. So the boys just concluded that had to be an angel that was God's answer to prayer for us. You have at least two angels watching out for you if you know the Lord Jesus Christ. And more than that, if you need them. God, I believe, especially when I get up every day, I think the Lord sends out an extra legion just to watch, you know, because they, you know, my family knows, right? Yep. So, anyway, let's pray. Father, we're grateful for the angels. We don't worship these angels. They are made lower than we are, a higher creation in your eyes. In Jesus Christ, we are your crowning creation. And Lord, they are ministering spirits sent to minister to us, to bless us and help us. And I wonder how many times we have entertained angels unaware, or how many times we've missed an opportunity to be able to be blessed, and to help. And that maybe is this what it means, Lord, when Jesus said, when I was naked, you didn't clothe me. When I was in prison, you didn't visit me. When I was sick, you didn't feed me. Because when you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. Oh, Lord, help us to be more mindful of those that come in and out of our lives, especially at our darkest moments. We just give you this day, and we thank you for this opportunity. We also give you thanks for the food, Lord, and for the potluck that we're about to partake. And we just thank you for everyone here today. Bless them in spirit, soul, and body. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.